until he got on the stage. And then he proved who he was.
The old lovesick blues boy, Hank Williams. Hank Sinatra, boy. Hank, I understand you've been out this week seeing a lot of the country and visiting with your friends out on the road. What one of the hit songs that you make that the folks seem to ask for oftenest right now, Hank?
Well, the one they seem to be asking for the mostest is a pitiful little song called the Long Gone Lonesome Blues. That's it. Yes, I went down to the river to watch the fish swim by. But I got to the river so lonesome I wanted to die, oh Lord. And then I jumped in the river, but the doggone river was dry. She's long gone, and now I'm lonesome blue.
He was the most cocky, most confident man I ever met in my life. He had a way of looking at you that said, you know who I am, Hoss? I am the greatest singer in the world. He would never say that, but he had a way of looking at you like that.
I tell you what, Ernest Tubb told me that Hank and him were traveling together somewhere, and he told Ernest, he said, you know, he said, man, he said, when I was a kid down there in Alabama, he said, I used to listen to Grand Ole Opry. And he said, I heard Roy Acuff when he came on there, and he said, I thought he was the greatest singer in the world. So he said, I started copying him, sang just like him. And he said, I could. I sounded just like him.
Sometime, somewhere, we'll meet again, dear. Then love will make the teardrop stop.
And he said, in 43, when you came on there with that electric guitar, he said, I thought you was the greatest thing I'd ever heard. So he said, I started trying to sing just like you. And he said, I could. I sounded just like you.
We've been together for so long. It hurts to know your love is gone.
And Ernie said, he leaned over and said, you know what I finally done? I got me a style in between you two sons of bitches. You can cut that out. Got me a style in between you two sons of bitches, and I kind of like it. That's what Hank told him. And if you'd listen, you could hear the screaming part of Acuff in his voice, and you hear Ernest Tubb phrasing all through it. So,
if you're loving me like I'm loving you, baby, we're really in love. If you're counting on me like I'm counting on you, oh, Cupid, just give us a shove. If you're dreaming of me like I'm dreaming of you, then I know what you're dreaming of. If you're loving me like I'm loving you, baby, we're really in love.
We moved from Shreveport to Nashville. The property on Franklin Road, when Mother and Daddy bought that property, it was out of the city limits at the time. There was only one other house around us.
If you go for me like I go for you, baby, we fit like a glove. If you're loving me like I'm loving you, baby, we're really in love.
An old friend. An old friend of long ago. I got a lot of memories tied up in this old car. It's a 1948 Packard. I don't know if it has a serial number, we just called it a limousine, Packard limousine. In a week's time, we would sometimes do 4,000 miles and play three or four dates. And it was a task, really.
Hank didn't care to ride in the front. Sometimes he'd ride back there because we had that way he had two radios that he could listen to two different ball games on. And so a lot of times we would use those jump seats there. One guy could sleep on those two seats.
Want to come say hi?
I used to.
Yeah, I reckon I was scared.
How you been?
I'm fine. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Yeah.
Well, where are you going in this car?
I don't know. You get in and you tell me and we'll go.
I tell you, we've been a lot of places, seen a lot of things.
Yeah, I've been somewhere twice.
Yeah.
Two or three places I've been
twice.
You know,
people ask me, would you do the same thing again? I would. I would. I have no regrets.
In a minute.
I'd do exactly the same thing again.
I would too, and for the same price.
Yeah.
Which was nothing.
Yeah.
This guy had a cigar in his mouth, playing jokes on everybody, the band. They were young. He was handsome. He was very attractive. And his legs were going to town, and he was 20-something years old. Bottom line, he was one of the first American superstars.
I think that there was a lot of people wanting to try causing trouble between them. And when Daddy would be out on the road without Mother, they would come to Mother and say, oh, well, you know, I saw Hank so-and-so while he was on the road. Or they would come to Daddy and say, you know, while you were out of town, I saw Audrey with so-and-so. And that would cause a friction between Mom and Daddy.
Well, Audrey called around, and Hank was passed out on the couch, and there was about a half-empty bottle, maybe, of whiskey on the coffee table. Audrey came in and hit him on the head with that bottle. And they said, you've killed Hank Williams. He said, no, he's not killed. Give me some water. And she threw water on him, got him up, and took him home.
Audrey was always very nice to me. But she had a way of riling Hank up, and he had a way of riling her up. And I don't know if it's his drinking it caused her to nag, or if it was her nagging caused him to drink. I never did know exactly what the formula was.
There's a tear in my beer, 'cause I'm crying for you, dear.
She deserved what her reputation she had. She was meaner than a snake. But they just really couldn't get along and with each other, or apparently without each other. We were brothers of the road. I worked with him 6 months before he ever took a drink. I did not realize how bad it could be. Once he took a drink, he could not quit until he reached absolute rock bottom.
Dear Hank, I kind of feel let down today after receiving your call, because I knew you were drinking again. And Hank, that is something I refuse to go for, because it only proves a man's weakness. Sometimes we humans act in a funny way when things are not going our way. If you love Audrey, why don't you try to straighten out and be a man enough to tell her you love her and you're willing to change? The trouble with you kids is both of y'all want to be the boss. Both of you have pride. Pride is one of the most destructive things on earth. I'm opening up my heart to you because I love you like my own son. And you can call on me anytime when you are in a problem. And I'll do anything within my power to help you help yourself. I am your friend, Fred Rose.
Fred Rose, who himself was an alcoholic, but he had found a way to master that, and it broke his heart that he couldn't get that through to Hank.
Legends don't look like legends when they're being made.
No.
They're just people.
Yeah,
they're just folks.
Yeah.
And we never noticed. I knew that Hank was special, and my mother was a good example. My mother was a very strict and staid and stable woman. And she didn't suffer fools lightly, nor sinners. But my mother didn't count. Said Hank didn't count.
Yeah.
I mean,
so he's different.
He's different. That boy suffered. And
you never walked in that boy's shoes.
Yeah, yeah. And I have a lot of those same feelings. And that was the secret, I think, of Hank was that he was every man's feelings, and he let his show and didn't care. Well, I don't. Maybe he cared, but. he would let his show, and that was what everybody was feeling.
Yeah.
By Joe, me gotta go, me oh my oh. Me gotta go, pull the Piro down the bayou.
Had a Cold Caravan was the last great medicine show. Had a Cold was a patent medicine. The guy that invented it, Dudley LeBlanc, said it had enough alcohol to make people feel good, 12%, and enough laxative for a good movement.
It was basically similar to the small medicine shows that Hank had been on many years before, 10 years before, only it was on a huge scale. There were 100 white and blue trucks that would parade through town that were all painted with the Hattacall on the side. There were these large name acts, Bob Hope, Dick Hames, Cesar Romero, Carmen Miranda.
Hank did his act, his lovesick blues, just had them eating out of his hand, you know. And we quit the stage and they started trying to introduce Bob Hope. And man, the crowd just kept rolling.
And finally, it quieted down a little bit, and they introduced Bob Hope. And he went walking out there. He had on a cowboy hat that high. And he said, "Hello, I'm Hank Hope." And they said, "Boo, we want Hank Williams by the hundreds."
And I know a spot right over the hill. That's so to pop and the dance is free. So if you want to have fun, come along with me. Say, hey, good cooking. What you got cooking? How's about cooking something up?
Hank had a barbecue place that he liked, so he took us all out there. These were old colored folks that had this little barbecue stand. And as we were leaving, Hank was fixing to get back in the car. The lady come out and said, "Oh, Mr. Williams, you dropped this." He usually carried $500-$600 with me. And he took the money clip off, put it in his hand, put that money back in that lady's hand, said, "Thank you." He didn't drop it accidentally. He dropped that on purpose. That was his way to give them old people a little bit of what he had. And Hank helped a lot of people and gets very little credit for it.
It's right four nights. At that time, he said, "You know," said Breck, said, "this is the lonesomest time of the day." I said, "Boy, what do you mean lonesome? All them pretty women on this train and you talking about being lonesome?" He said, "I don't have nothing to do with them." I said, "Why?" He said, "They think they're better than I am." I said, "Hank, don't you never think that." I said, "You better than every one of them out there. Don't never believe that." He couldn't believe what he was.